concept, along with the concept of the historical piece as well. You know, we talked about the fact that we were working on a historical district. And then there was some discussion about the convenience of establishing a historical zone, which could coincide with the DDA zone, which one could supplement and augment the other. In other words, you establish a historical zone, and then you provide a DDA for people to come in here and take these buildings, for instance, that are established as historical sites, and be able to access dollars. And of course, historically, they have to be preserved as is on the outside, which causes them to have to use as much materials as far as, you know, renovating and the like.
I can speak to my background, at least prior to, I've been with the city of McHenry now for almost 9 years, but prior to that, for 7 years, I worked in economic development for the Southern Georgia Regional Commission. And over the course of that time, we were able to obtain about $15 million in grant low-interest loan money for our 10-county region at that time. Some of that was downtown development dollars. But the historic preservation component was really wholly contained within the planning department. And there are some great, very intelligent, highly effective folks, and of course you have one who originally started this process, who's now the Del Bosco Historic Preservationist, and has come up and presented to the council to be able to get that going again. As far as that effort, we have a member who has passed, and the Historic Preservation Historical Society needs to appoint another representative to fill that vacancy, and then we'll have another meeting. But I would caution the council, at least from my perspective, against linking those two concepts.
Okay.
I see historic preservation as having its place, and I certainly think it has a vital and important place within the city of Tejera and within development as a whole. But the mission, I believe, is different. I appreciate, like I said, the vitality and the importance that preservation presents. And I think that preserving history is important. But I think a DDA, a Downtown Development Authority, in some respects can have a joint mission, but in many respects has a separate mission. And that mission is the development of the city. And it can, yes, dovetail in to many of the Historic Preservation Commission's goals. You can have preservation and you can have development at the same time. But a DDA, their goal is to see a building renovated, to see it occupied. Historic preservation's goal is to see that building preserved, not to see it occupied. I know that historic preservationists believe and fully expect that a building that is not vacant is one that is maintained. But at the same time, their goal is the preservation of the building, not the people within it. A DDA's goal is to employ people and to make jobs and to see vitality arrive in the form of dollars, in the form of foot traffic in businesses, and that is not necessarily the same mission of a historic preservation.
So your advice, based on your experience, just what you were talking about, would say that we should, if we so chose to move forward with the development of the Downtown Development Authority, then it would behoove us to do this independently of the other entity and allow it to develop itself on its own.
That would be my recommendation. I mean, as far as the most recent meeting of the Historic Preservation Commission Study Committee, we had a consensus among the group to identify separate historical structures and see about designating a district. And in that process, whenever a public hearing is required, whenever property owners are approached, 50% threshold has to be achieved for them to have that district designated and for them to fall underneath the purview of a Historic Preservation Commission. A DDA doesn't have that requirement.
Okay.
A DDA does not have taxing authority, but a DDA is enacted by this body, by this council, and private property input specifically for the respect of any type of referendum or acknowledgement is not required. So, I mean, and having said that, we have, I believe, done a lot of due diligence in talking with many of the property owners and business owners about an EDA. But it, in and of itself, is a different mission and a different goal.
So, Ken, would you think if we wanted to start this discussion, that it would be good for us to ask our city manager to come up with some kind of a plan for us on the steps it would take for us to do that? And so that it gives us something to have in hand that we can review and discuss, because I know there's got to be a step-by-step process by which you do this.
Yes, I think that's a good idea. In fact, there's an outline step-by-step process in a Downtown Development Authority handbook. There's a DDA handbook created by the Georgia Municipal Association, and I don't know if you don't have a copy of it.
I got it. Yes. Was that one that in that material that you picked up?
It is,
there?
Okay. And there is a 6 or 8 step process delineated in that particular document. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have to follow it step by step, but there's some pretty,
right.
I think it's a pretty wise process
right.
that covers a lot of things that you should probably cover in making a plan like that. One thing to keep in mind is that a DDA is not necessarily something that you print out, and it's not something that you print out, and a process like that would be specific to each municipality creating the new statutory DDAs, in that you would tailor it more or less to your specific needs. In other words, if you don't want it to do a particular thing, you write it in. You write it within the guidelines of Georgia state law, how you want it to be. And a statutory DDA is the most inflexible with respect to the powers of the DDA itself, and the most flexible with the powers of the municipality, the government, municipal government, to, for lack of a better word, control it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So that step-by-step process is very necessary. I think that's a good idea. And yes, I would think it would be a good step if we decided that this was what we wanted to do, to go ahead and look at what steps we would need all the way out to the end.
So why wouldn't we, at our next meeting on Thursday, make a motion that we appoint the city manager and mayor to come up with this information for us for the next meeting, so that and disperse it to us as quickly as possible so that we have time?
It's been dispersed. The link that I shared with you after, I shared a link for this packet, but I then also shared a link for the DDA folder. So, and I could resend it, but in that folder is the DDA manual, and if you want to write down page 16, that is the steps in creating the Downtown Development Authority.
Okay.
So it's very clear, step one, step two, step three.
That's our issue, page 10.
Correct, and it's on page 16. So if you want to talk about it more on Thursday night, we can, or if you want to, whatever the will of the council is, we can.
First step is to have a vote by the, or come up with an area. They go to those business area and have them sign a declaration, yeah, they want it or yeah, they don't want it. And we'll waste a lot of time.
One step is you got to come up with an area.
Right. And so you want to do the steps. I think the first step is to come up with a map of a DDA area. Then you go to the merchants in that area, and now, you know, we're talking about the political, this is close to $1 million in renovation, just to get in the safe mode tonight. Well, first off, DDA has got raised tax money. I guarantee a loan to borrow $1 million, that's a lot of money in these businesses in this district.
There's grant on that that's out there.
But grants are $250,000.
Well, they can't raise taxes
to the district.
They have to vote on that themselves, and again, that's not fair. still say no to that.
What I think would be ideal, I'm glad you mentioned that, because it's a good point. What I think would be ideal is that there are different ways to fund a DDA once you enact it. And what I mentioned a couple of times was that grants and low-interest loans would probably, in my opinion, be the most ideal way to fund a DDA. I certainly have no desire to set up any kind of an entity that has the power to raise taxes on our community. I don't have any interest in setting up a DDA specifically that wants to raise taxes on the business district for any project. Now, that doesn't mean that a future council might not think that's a good idea. I personally don't think it is a good idea. I think the grants and the low interest loans that are available through money administered through a separate entity but governed under the Georgia Municipal Association. They're the ones that do the low-interest loan program. Those are the only two things right now that I think are viable options for to fund the DDA, not increase taxes.
The DDA can't go off and borrow money from the bank unless they can show the bank they've got revenue coming in. The only way the DDA is going to get revenue coming in is taxation to the businesses. So you've got to be putting the horse before the cart. So the bank's not going to give money, say, we're DDA, knowing that the city is not obligated to pay that back. And the DDA has basically no revenue coming in, they don't tax.
So I understand that
point. Maximum loans out there, grants are like $250,000.
And we went to Atlanta, let me respond to that for a second. We went to Atlanta last January, we participated in the Downtown Development Authority program that taught us a lot about that actually. And that was brought up in a panel at the end of the session. They spent at least an hour with this panel of people asking them questions. I think there were six or seven different representatives from various DDAs throughout the state. Several of them were completely funded by no tax dollars, by no local tax dollars at all. They did not raise taxes, and their funding and resources that they or capital that they needed to go to a bank were handled another way. They don't have to borrow from a local bank. They don't have to borrow from a bank at all. They can do it on the merits of the project, just like a private bank would do, to borrow through the GMA. And that maximum amount of the GMA is $250,000 through the 50-40-10 program that explained to us. That is done on the merits of the project itself. And a private bank will do it that way as well. So that was addressed. I understand why that's a concern. Good concern.
Well,
because you might step up with banks and a lot of
the only property right now we got the city owns is a park across the street where we're signing the number of apartments.
And
the other building, you're talking close to $1 million to put it into a safe state. If you go off and borrow that money privately, so we get $250 in a grant. Now, you go to a bank or somebody else, they want to have to turn them over to the DCA, and have to give them the title. The other, well, that's not going to cover a $750,000 note. So they're going to want to know where the rest of the money's going to come from. So we're going to say, a year from now, we're going to have rent for a certain dollar. Well, the bank's not going to sit and wait a year. No lending institution will do that. So somehow, we have the mortgage property, or the railroad property, whatever, that's the bottom of slots.
Well, that's not the only way that you do that. There are a lot of ways, there are other ways that you can take that property and rent it. The city doesn't have to do that. The city can find someone who wants to do that. Well, the only way a person would want to step in there and do that is if we could provide a DDA could provide for them some assistance in no interest or low interest loans that would be available through it. It would enhance the potential of someone in the private sector from wanting to get involved in the business.
As far as my knowledge, nobody's even inquired about it.
So. And it's because most people who would invest that kind of money don't want to invest it in something that doesn't have the backing of something like a DDA. Most people are developing these types of things.
They could say, we need to have a DDA. nobody's wanting.
And the funding that Councilor Davis is speaking of is $250,000, but there's a couple other programs out there. The Downtown Development Revolving Loan Fund through the Department of Community Affairs is another $250,000. And more importantly, the Redevelopment Fund, which is set aside money through the Community Development Block Grant Small Cities Program, is $500,000 that can be made available in the form of a grant if it's elimination of slum and block.
I remember correctly, what's her name, who came down to give us the briefing?
Mayor Rich.
Mayor Rich, said there was very little money out of there right now.
Oh, no, there's $1.5 million that's annually allocated through Small Cities Program for DDA.
Okay, I've spent enough time talking.
Are those buildings, let me ask you, are those buildings considered two separate addresses? Are they two separate addresses, so they can be considered actually two separate buildings, correct?
You're talking about Silver Bluffs and Ten Bucket?
From a legal standpoint, perhaps. From a historic preservation standpoint, probably not.
From a legal standpoint?
From a legal standpoint, yes.
For instance, if you were to say they're two separate properties that are eligible for two separate funds, So if you just double that amount of money that you're talking about, if you consider two separate parcels.
Funding is, there's funding out there. Funding is available. And funding that would not require private borrowing, funding that would not require any sort of tax dollars. It is something that communities all over the state have done.
And it has been considered two separate buildings because we did have two addresses in it at one time. We had the Mr. Odom, the lawyer, had the legal firm there, and we also had an exercise pass.
So just one of the things there, the big thing is two separate parcels.
Yeah,
it was one parcel.
I guess that one did agree that both the ownership and the project that you're working on is going to be developed as a solo, as a combined project.
Okay. I'm just wondering if you did one half.
But if you broke it up and.
You can break it up into phases. I mean, the DDA in conjunction with the city could look and say, okay, well, we want to make it stabilized enough to where the first floor is developed and start building a revenue stream from commercial development for anybody that might come in. And who knows, once that building is occupied, what may happen with somebody who looks and sees that, you know, there's a potential here for 6,000 additional square feet of space on the second floor and the third floor, and, you know, an investor might come along that might take the entire property off the city's hands. So
no way you can do one third of the building. You gotta do it publicly, you got to strike the system in, floor doors for that, second floor, ceiling doors on third floor bad.
So you have to do the structural part,
the structural part,
all the way.
But $1 million could be done in phases. Walter Alman said that. $1 million could be done in phases. It would not have to be done.
You're not gonna be able to rent it until it's complete. But you got to start at the top and the bottom. Well, you're going to cut the whole building. All you're going to have is four walls.
I think there are other options that are out there.
So we won't know until we get into it.
All right.
We won't know until the process is started. So I would say that I would like to.
And
it's a bit forward with Ken's suggestion that we
authorize
to start some kind of process, authorize our city manager to get us started.
So the first process is get a map and then get the consensus of the business. That's, you got to know where you're starting from.
Whatever the proper protocol is, we should follow.
I'd just like, if possible, Mayor, a motion to that effect on Thursday to instruct me to put together
a
potential map. Yeah. And here's the next question. I mean, because it's seven vacancies that would be on the board. Do you want to begin to prepare a list, or do you want to, do you just want to look at the map right now? How do you want to attack that?
Let's build the map and we'll start with the list.
Right.
This map and find out what the business is want and then go from there. So in August, you'll have a map.
Well, you had an event in December that got input from businesses.
No, but you got to have the right, you got to have these businesses saying, yes, we want to go into the DDA.
Yeah, you might have, you might be taxed. So you gotta get, you gotta have
51.1%.
Yeah, that's a tax district. A DDA is not a tax district.
Well, then we're gonna write the grant and the prototype DDA has no tax authority.
This DDA would have no tax authority.
It's already state law.
No, it's not.
You talking about this stuff? You talking about within the district itself?
Within the district.
Okay.
The district, you can't tell that district they can't tax the DDA.
The DDA controls the creation of a tax district within the designated area.
Right.
Just to increase the millage rate to fund specific projects in like streetscapes like they did.
Thank you.
It's separate, but, and then that creation of that tax district has to be, that has nothing to do with the formation of.
Only with the citizens in that district.
It has nothing to do with the formation of the DDA. There is not any tax district that is conjunction with the formation of the DDA. It is a completely separate process.
The DDA can impose a tax in the district.
Not without a referendum.
That's what's separate.
They're not the ones that have made the decision on tax.
The people in that district, 51% of them have to agree for a tax district. That's what I'm saying.
But the creation of the DDA is not related to that. Well, a tax district is a completely separate thing. A DDA is an entity that can receive grants and loans over a specified area to develop property. A tax district is a separate initiative that can be engaged in by DDA, but that requires input over the residents within that area.
That's right. That's what I just said, that 51% of the people in the district.
But that's not required for the creation of DDA.
Well, but
that's only if they want to tax themselves.
Yeah.
Correct.
Okay.
I know this is going to come up again, so I want to clarify something with Mayor Pro Tem and then me. Were you suggesting, in the process of the creation of the DDA document, if and when it comes back, you want to inhibit the district from taxing itself?
You can't do that.
Well, that's what I was saying. It sounded like that.
No, but I'm saying that once you form a DDA, they got to cost you a lot of things. This council has nothing to do.
That's not really true. Not under statutory.
As long as they're citizens, as long as 51% of the people in that district say, we support taxing or taxing that district.
Our service.
Not this council has nothing to do.
The voters authorize that.
Only the voters would have to vote. Only the people in the district.
That's right.
Yeah, that's what I said.
The taxes themselves.
It's not related to the creation of the
51%.
That's right. That's right.
51% of the
people. You're right.
Yes, I know. I've read all that. I've read 183 pages of bullshit.
So are they. They're talking about two different things. You are right. They can't do that. But it's got nothing to do with the creation of the DDA itself.
A DDA can form a urban development agency within itself. That means they have eminent domain rights.
No. Yes, they can.
But we do
have 183 pages. They can form a urban redevelopment authority. Then the DDA can do that. And then they can take.
That's completely different from downtown
development. No, the downtown development authority, according to that 183 pages I read, can.
It's a different section of the law.
Right, it's a different section, but the DDA can institute an urban redevelopment authority.
Think of it like what you're speaking of, an urban redevelopment authority. It is like a tourism authority and an industrial authority. They're both sanctioned by the local governments, but they have two different missions. So if at some point down the road, y'all wanted to look at urban redevelopment in a designated area, then underneath a provision of the law, you could do that. But a DDA doesn't have that mission, different section of the law, a different authority. Different.
Okay, this says it too. This downtown development authority law, written by Brandon Bowen, who sent us. I see that.
projects in context of activities that the DDA has authorized in relation to project meetings. E, any undertaking under the urban redevelopment law which the DDA has designated as an urban redevelopment agency.
If it's been designated as that.
Well, they could. The DDA can do that.
This council can do a lot of things, yeah, but the DDA can't do it without the bid of the council.
Not according to 182 pages. Go read that.
No, actually, it is in there. It says, and that's what I stated in my original statement, that it's, that a statutory DDA is the most restricted with the powers of a DDA, and it is the most flexible with respect to the council's powers controlling the DDA. So we, yes, we can. As a city council, we can restrict them from doing that.
Only if it's in the original writing. If we take the original DDA law and we lay out what their boundaries are, it's different. But if you give, if they meet and go to the Georgia Code, then they create that carte blanche. So if you want to sit there and talk about restrictions, then those restrictions got to be in the what do you call it, the document? Let's call it document there, Mr. Lawyer. Not the code.
What resolution?
Resolution.
Yeah.
Specify everything in the resolution, and that would be an awful long resolution. But then you've got to sign off the
paper. Okay, we know what we're doing?
Yeah.
We're going to take and get a map and hear from the business owners.
Now, I'm not to get a red map by Thursday night.
No, I thought it was all...
Just, we will be voting on for you to do this.
Okay. So just the steps, as Councilman Barfield suggested.
Okay.
Go on. Oh, this is got a drop hole and run up here.